Forward and Chapter 1, Number 17, by J. Jefferson Farjeon. Forward. I usually avoid dedications, because if they're not bare statements, they're too apt to involve a grace of florid expression at variance with sincerity. But this novel seems to me to be insisting on a few words, since it is based on a play, the success of which has formed one of the happiest and most important milestones of my career. At once, however, I find myself confounded. To whom shall I dedicate the book? To my wife, who shares with me the fruits of this success? To Mr. Leon M. Lyon, whose skill and experience materialized those fruits? To the actors and actresses, without whose cooperation all this good fortune could not have been achieved? Or to the original Ben, who could never have been born in my mind had I not met him somewhere, but I cannot say where, on some uncharted, unrecorded journey? The task of selection is beyond me. In joyous despair, I dedicate this book to all. Chapter 1. Fog had London by the throat. It blinded its eyes and muffled its ears. Such traffic as was not at a standstill groped its way with scarcely a sound through the jaundiced streets, and to cross a road was no longer a casual matter but an adventure into the unknown. For this reason the timid stayed indoors while the more daring and those who had no choice groped gingerly along the pavements. The pickpockets were busy. But it is not in the heart of London that our story commences. The fog had stretched its fingers far and wide, and a man who was approaching along one of the arteries that led Londonwards from the northeast paused for a few moments to rub his eyes, and then his stubbly chin. "God help us," he muttered, staring into the great gloomy smudge ahead of him. "If that ain't the Yeller Peril, what is?" He had trudged out of a land of sunshine into a land of white mist, and now the white mist was becoming opaque orange. The prospect was so thoroughly unappetizing that he even considered the idea of turning back. Had he known what awaited him in that gloomy smudge, he would have acted very promptly on the idea. But the future itself is as impenetrable as a fog, and he decided to go on. "Arter all," he argued to himself, "one place as good as another, when you ain't got nowhere else." So he lit his best cigarette, barely more than half of it had been smoked by its previous owner, and resumed his way. A figure suddenly loomed towards him, out of the mist. "Oi!" exclaimed our traveller, and jumped. His nerves were never of the best, and hunger was beginning to tell on him. But he reacted quickly and grinned as the figure stopped. "Why didn't yer sound yer ooter?" The figure grinned too. "A bit thick, mate, isn't it?" said the stranger. "Thick as cheese. Cheese! Lummy, I wish I had a bit of cheese. Hungry?" "Not half. You ain't got such a thing as a leg of beef on you, I s'pose." The other laughed. "There's an inn a little way up the road." "Ah! Well, just run back and tell him to put down the red carpet, will you? Ben of the merchant service is a-coming, and he's got fourpence to spend. Oi! Where are you going? Oi!" The stranger had turned and darted off. Ben of the merchant service stared after him. "Well, if that don't take the bloomin' ticket," he murmured. "Seemed like as if he thought I'd meant it." Once more an instinct rose in him to turn back. He was just entering the fringe of the thick fog belt, and its uncanniness depressed him. He recalled that the stranger had stood almost next to him, yet he had not seen his face. Out of the fog he'd come, and back into the fog he'd returned. A shadow with a voice, that was all. But the glory of the merchant service, however humble your position in it, must be maintained. You could not let it down, not at least until you were sure you were going to get hurt. And after all, what was a little bit of fog? So, deriding himself for his fears, the subtle source of which he was not fitted to understand, he again ignored the kindly warning and resumed his onward trudge. The thought of the inn a little way up the road certainly did something to dissipate the gloom. Fourpence wouldn't go far, but a friendly innkeeper might make it go a little farther. Then he might earn a few coppers by doing something, you never knew. Ben, of the merchant service, perhaps it should be explained, late of the merchant service, was not in love with work. The stomach, however, drives. He came upon the inn abruptly. All meetings are abrupt in a fog. It loomed up, a vague, shadowy outline on his right, and a feeble lamp burned over the door. Ben plunged his hand into his pocket to corroborate his impression of his bank balance, and found the impression correct, and entered. If he hoped to escape the fog inside, he was disappointed. The bar parlour was full of it. A cough directed him to the counter, and he found a young woman peering at him with half-frowning eyes.
"It's all right, miss," Ben assured her. "I ain't no matinee idol, but then, on the other hand, I ain't so bad as I looks. How far'll fourpence go?"
The young woman smiled, glanced towards an inner room, and then turned back to Ben.
"Fourpence won't go far," she commented. "It ain't so dusty, miss, with a bit of good nature thrown in," said Ben slyly.
"How do you know I've got any good nature?" she retorted.
"It's a guess, miss, but I reckon it's a good un. Anyhow, I see you doesn't lose by it. I'll leave your me diamond studs in my will."
Her smile grew more friendly, but once more she glanced towards the inner room. Ben began to grow vaguely uneasy.
"What you got in there, miss?" he asked. "A hogger?"
The woman shook her head, as though impatient with herself. "No, just another customer," she replied.
"Then what you keep on?"
"Nothing. What do you want for your fourpence?"
"Soup, fish, cut of the joint, and a couple of veg," grinned Ben cheekily. "Go on. You don't want much, do you?" laughed the woman. "Well, I must say, you look as if you could do with it. I'll see what I can manage. Get in there."
"Eh? What's that?" jerked Ben. He glanced toward the door of the inner room at which she was pointing.
"What's the matter?" she demanded. "He won't eat you."
"Who said he would?" retorted Ben and shuffled towards the door. The door was closed, and he opened it slowly and cautiously. Whatever the young woman might say, something was disturbing her, and that something was in the inner room. All right, then. No one was afraid. Just the same, didn't arm to be careful, did it? When he'd opened the door a little more than a crack, he paused. 2 seconds of inaction went by. Then he whispered over his shoulder to the young woman,
"Ain't you giving us a light?"
"Don't be silly," replied the woman.
"Isn't a lamp good enough?"
"There ain't no lamp, miss."
"No lamp? Here you do want something to eat.
Open the door a bit wider, then you'll see."
"I tells yer, there ain't no light," whispered Ben. "And I ain't gone—"
He stopped abruptly. The woman stared at him, now frankly uneasy. Her mouth remained half open while 5 more inactive seconds went by. Then suddenly a violent shiver revivified the statuesque figure of Ben, and he swiftly and silently closed the door.
"Goodness, what's that?" asked the woman with her hand at her heart.
Ben slithered to a seat and, sitting down abruptly, blinked at her.
"What is it?
What is it?" repeated the woman in a low voice.
"I ain't going in there," muttered Ben.
"For goodness sake."
"I'll tell you, miss, just a minute. Sort of took me in the wind, like. There wasn't no light, see? What I says, if you've give him one, he's put it out. And all I sees, miss, when I looks in that there room, was nothing. Nothing."
"All right, I heard you the first time," interposed the woman. "Don't give me the creeps. Oh, dear, I wish father was home. That I do. Well, what made you shut the door so quick?"
Ben looked at her, slightly injured. "Ain't I telling you?" he demanded. "All right, then. I sees nothing, as I says, but then sudden-like, I sees something. It's a figure. Your customer, I reckons, miss. But he ain't sitting at the table. He ain't doing that."
"What's he doing, then?"
"He seems to be listening, miss," said Ben sepulchrally. "Standing by the wall, he is. Listening, miss, listening."
"Oh, hark to the man," gasped the young woman with her eyes on the door. "Now he's off again."
"Yes, but that ain't all," he went on. "I sees the winder. Lummy, I sees the winder, and all of a sudden another figure outside pops up agin it and shoves his face agin the glass."
The woman stifled a little shriek while Ben took out a large red handkerchief and mopped his brow.
"So, arter that," he concluded, "I closes the door and comes away, and so'd anyone."
There was a short pause. The young woman appeared undecided what to do.
"What did he look like, the man at the window?" she asked.
"Nothing. You couldn't see," replied Ben. "Just shadders, both on 'em."
"What do they call them black things?"
"Silhouettes.
don't they? Well, that's what they was. Couple of silly heads. But I dunno, he added reflectively. I did seem to recognize that chap at the window in a kind of a way. Seemed like a feller I met up the road, somehow. I dunno. A practical streak entered into him. What you going to do, miss? Go in and light his lamp for him again? Not me, she retorted. Of course not, agreed Ben. And no more ain't I going in there to heat my Carlton lunch. You can eat it in here if you like. Yes, I do like. Though mind you, miss, if it wasn't for you, I'd hook it. The young woman looked at Ben a little more intently after this frank statement, and a new light came into her eye. You haven't got no call to stay here for me, she said, watching him. Yes, I have, he responded. The call of the merchant service. Oh, are you in the merchant service, then? Well, speaking strict, miss, answered Ben carefully, I have been, and hopes to be again, but just now, get me? I see, she nodded. You're out of a job. That's right. Man of leisure. Well, I've got a brother in the merchant service, and you can keep your fourpence, said the young woman. I ain't going to charge you for your Carlton lunch, as you call it. You stay here till my father returns. That's all I ask. And you doesn't ask in vain, exclaimed Ben roundly. I'll protect you. Oh, my God, what's that? The door of the inner room flew open. A figure darted across the floor and vanished through the porch. End of chapter 1. Chapter 2. Number 17. By J. Jefferson Farjeon. Ben stared at the street door, now open wide, and then at the young woman whose hands were clasped in fright. Ben's own heart was beating somewhat rapidly. "Was that your customer, miss?" he asked. "Yes," she gasped. "Oh, dear, what's it all mean?" Ben had a theory, but before expounding it he played for security. Both the street door and the door to the inner room were open. They required closing. He walked to the street door first. He peered cautiously out into the wall of yellow, coughed, drew his head in again, and closed the door. Then, even more cautiously, he shuffled across to the inner room, a small portion of which was dimly discernible through the aperture.
"Is there anybody in there?"
whispered the woman. "If there is, he can blinkin' well stay," Ben whispered back as he whipped the door to and locked it. "The only chap it'd be is that chap what was at the winder, and if he come in at the winder, then he can go out at the winder. I reckon that's fair, innit?" "Yes," murmured the woman. "Why do you suppose he ran out like that?" "'Cause he was running away from somebody," answered Ben obviously. "And the somebody was the chap at the winder. Plain as a pikestaff, innit? I didn't seek in the fog." "Yes, and you thought something was up afore I come along, didn't you?" "Yes," she nodded. "He acted so peculiar."
"How peculiar?"
"Well, he put his head in first and had a quick look round. Then he went out again, and then he came in again. 'Say, give me something to eat,' he says, 'and I've no time to waste.' One of those Yanks. I never did like him, and he goes into that room just as if the whole place belonged to him. That's a Yank," said Ben. "And once, when my back was turned," she went on, "he came out of the room quietly and gave me such a turn, he went to have a look out of the front door, and I said, 'Isn't the fog awful?' just to make conversation, and he grinned and replied, 'I like it. I like it,' he said, and then went back to the room sudden as if it was a joke. Of course, I thought I was just silly," she concluded, "thinking that way about him, but you see, I wasn't." "No, you wasn't," agreed Ben. "He's a wrong un." He glanced uneasily at the door of the inner room, and the young woman followed his glance. "I say," she said quietly, "suppose there is somebody in there?"
"That's why I locked it," replied Ben.
"Yes, but oughtn't we to go in and have a look around?"
"Not till I've got something in my stomach. What about that Carlton lunch, miss?"
"Yes, in a minute," she answered, her eyes still glued on the door. "I think we ought to have that look round first, though."
"Wrong order, miss," Ben assured her. Eat first, heroism afterwards is a matter in the merchant service.
But she hardly listened to him. In spite of her fear, a sense of duty was reasserting itself within her, and Ben noted this transition with inward misgivings.
You wait a minute, murmured the young woman, coming away from the counter. I'm going to open that door.
Ben protested.
Wait a minute yourself, he said. You're acting silly.
No, I'm not, unless you mean I'm acting silly standing here doing nothing.
Here, off a mo,
gasped Ben as she made another movement towards the locked door.
I'll show you you're silly if you like.
Go on then, she answered, pausing.
But be quick about it. Don't take two ticks. First, suppose there ain't nothing in that there room.
I don't suppose there will be.
All right, then. What's the use of wasting your time going in?
But there might be something.
Ah, then you'd be an idiot to go in, exclaimed Ben triumphantly, crowning his point. Get me? I get that you've no pluck, she retorted, frowning. Ah, you ought to seed me in the war, miss. I was blowed up by a mine once and come down singing. Gone with you, she said, trying to remain severe and finding it rather difficult. He was a queer card. If that's true, go in there singing. She took hold of his arm, but he backed hastily away. That's different, he frowned. We was all together in the war, like, but what's to say there ain't a corpse in there? Here, enough of that, cried the woman. Lummy, muttered Ben, following his new train of thought. I'll bet that's what it is, a blinkin' corpse. That feller at the window got in arter that yank. The yank murders him, and ups it. Gentle perspiration moistened the theorist's brow as he added, Nah, miss, who's going to open that door?
I am, responded the woman breathlessly. Ben's theory terrified her, but it also decided her. The man in there might not be dead. He might be merely hurt and require their aid. The utter silence that came from the inner room lent colour to these notions. Yes, yes, clearly the door must be unlocked and opened without any more delay.
All right, your will have it, chattered Ben as she turned the key.
He looked round for a missile or weapon of some sort. A wooden chair was nearest, and he seized that. The door was flung open, and the woman entered. Some breathless moments went by. She did not reappear.
Oi! Shouted Ben in a sudden frenzy. Oi!
Raising his chair high, he approached the door, but sprang back as the woman suddenly reappeared.
Lor, love a duck! He gasped. What you want to spring at a fellow like that for?
I wasn't springing. You did the spring, she retorted. And if you're a specimen of the merchant service, then I'd sooner trust myself in a train.
You can't do nothing when you're hungry, growled Ben. What you find in there?
Nothing.
What?
Nothing at all?
Nothing at all.
Ben drank in this reassuring news. It put a new angle on things. He lowered his chair and straightened his back, straightened it as far as it would straighten, that is. Then he said impressively,
You was too quick, you was, miss. You didn't give me no time, see? I'm a-goin' in.
He marched to the door, but even though he knew the room was empty, he hesitated for an instant on the brink. Almost pitch dark, for the light that should have entered the window was practically fogged out. It looked a gloomy hole. He could just discern the outline of the table in the middle of the room, and of a chair that seemed to have been hastily shoved aside. Yes, a very gloomy hole, yet a palace of delight to another Ben was soon to enter.
"I thought you were going in," observed a sarcastic voice behind him. "So I am going in," retorted Ben. "But I ain't no express train."
He entered cautiously. She had said the room was empty, but after all there might be somebody under the table or behind that big armchair in the corner. He groped about, and suddenly, like a child anxious to get a nasty business over, he bent down and lifted an edge of the tablecloth. That he saw nothing was, at first, no proof that there was nothing to see, because in his terror, lest he should see a pair of eyes staring out at him, he had instinctively closed his own eyes. But when he opened them, they met blankness, and he breathed again.
"Thank God," he murmured. "This is a nasty business. S'help me, it is."
His mind relieved, he now proceeded to examine the room with elaborate thoroughness. If the merchant service had lagged behind a little, it would at least prove that when it once tackled a job, it tackled it properly. Ben examined the table, noticing the half-finished meal, which, in other circumstances, he would very promptly have finished. And then he looked behind all the chairs. Yes, even the big ones with the backs you couldn't see round. He did take one curtain for granted, but he prodded the other one, and as he did so, something slipped off the bottom of it.
"Hallo? What's this?" he queried.
He stooped and picked up the object. In the gloom he could hardly distinguish what it was, but it appeared to be a small cardboard ticket or badge. He struck a match. The light flared abruptly upon a number written large upon the cardboard surface.
17, muttered Ben, staring at it. "What the hell's that mean, number 17?
He dropped the match suddenly. Someone had entered the bar parlor from the road. He could hear the steps.
"Lummy!"
Then he smiled.
"Idiot,"
he thought. "Her father come home, of course." He strode out of the room, making a brave show, and nearly fell into the arms of a policeman.
"Hallo!" exclaimed the policeman. "What's this?"
For a moment, Ben was wordless. He never did feel really comfortable with policemen, and the woman explained.
"Oh, he's all right," she said. "Don't worry about him, but I'm glad you've come. There's been funny goings on here, I can tell you."
"Yes, that's why I've come," answered the constable. "This is pickpocket's weather, and I've seen some funny characters round about here." He looked at Ben suspiciously.
"I ain't too sure this ain't one of them." "Who, me?" expostulated Ben indignantly. "Well, that ain't sorce. Here I stays to protect a gal, and now you comes along."
"Steady, steady," interposed the constable. "There's funny people about, I tell you, and I've seen some of them about this place. One ran out of this inn just now, but I couldn't catch him."
"Yes, there was something funny about him," agreed the woman. "He left in a hurry, without even finishing his meal."
"And I expect this man would have left in a hurry, too," observed the constable, ironically. "Open your hand. What have you got there?"
"What, this?" answered Ben. "Picked it up in that room there just now. Here, don't snatch."
The constable whipped the piece of cardboard out of Ben's hand.
"Hallo!"
he exclaimed.
"What's this?" "My age," replied Ben. "Now then, don't be funny," frowned the constable. "Well, how do I know what it is?" retorted Ben. "You ain't give me time to look yet. Got it off the floor."
"Yes, so you say," interposed the constable and turned to the woman. "Have you seen this before?"
"No, never."
"He says he picked it off the floor in the next room."
"Well, he may have done so." "Were you in the next room before him?"
"Yes, I was."
"And you didn't see anything on the floor?"
"No, but it was dark. I didn't look everywhere. I expected it belonged to that other man."
"Oh, you do? Well, that's got to be proved, and meanwhile it's on this man."
"Yes, but what is it anyway?" asked the woman, trying to get a peep at it.
"Something mighty queer," replied the constable darkly. "Don't ask no questions, and you won't be told no lies. But I dare say our friend here..."
He turned to Ben, but Ben was gone. He had decided to forego his Carlton luncheon. End of chapter 2. Chapter 3. Number 17, by J. Jefferson Farjeon. Swallowed completely by the fog, for the first time Ben appreciated it. Perhaps he had left the inn more hurriedly than wisely, and the sacrifice of a good square meal certainly rankled in his hungry breast. But Ben liked a quiet life. He'd only chosen the sea because it took him away from the land, and it had seemed to him that he'd been caught up in a network of uncomfortable matters which were of no concern of his, and for which he was in no way responsible. That being so, he argued that the best thing he could do was to cut quite clear of them and to begin, so to speak, afresh. The constable may have been talking through his hat, of course. He may have been saying more than he meant. But, contrarywise, he may have meant more than he said, and Ben did not see why he should take any chances, particularly with a nice, comfortable, all-concealing fog just outside. So into the fog he had slipped, and through it he now ran, in the innocent belief that his troubles were over. He managed to steer an uninterrupted course for a full 10 minutes, and then the person he bumped into was nothing more alarming than an elderly gentleman with a bad corn.
"Where are you going to?" barked the elderly gentleman. "Same spot as you was," replied Ben, hunger and the fog rendering him something of a daredevil.
As he hurried on, he recalled the gleam of the elderly gentleman's gold watch-chain, and he wondered how many square miles that could have been converted into.
"It's a lucky thing for gold watches," he reflected, "that my mother taught me to say my prayers regular."
Presently, feeling secure, he slackened his pace, and indeed this was necessary, for although he could not see London, he felt it beginning to envelop him. Houses loomed up when he hit one side of the road or the other. People became more frequent, and meetings ceased to be events or bumpings to surprise. Traffic groped and hooted along the road. Lamp posts dawned a mile away one moment, and upon you the next, and every now and again voices were suddenly raised in warning or anxiety or irony. The fog entered Ben's brain as well as his eyes. Soon he was walking in a sort of trance. If you had stopped him and asked where he was walking, he could not have told you, and he might have had difficulty also in telling you why he walked, until at any rate he had had several seconds to consider the matter. He was travelling very much like a rudderless ship, borne by the tide into whatever port, or onto whatever rocks that tide decreed. But at last, Ben's dormant will did assert itself for a brief instant, though even here fate selected the particular restaurant into which he turned, to add another link to the strange chain that was binding him. It was, of course, a cheap restaurant, for an out-of-work seaman can patronise no other, and it was nearly empty. Ben shuffled to a pew-like seat with a high back, sat down and ordered a cup of tea and as much bread and butter as would be covered by fourpence. Then he settled himself to his simple meal, comparing it regretfully with the more lavish repast he had missed earlier in the day. He was seated near the end of the long, narrow room, and only one table lay beyond, a table completely hidden by the high back of his bench. He had vaguely imagined this end table to be unoccupied, but suddenly a word fell upon his ears, and he paused in the act of conveying a substantial piece of bread and butter to his mouth, for the word he had heard was 17.
"That's rum," he thought. "Seems as if I can't get away from the blinkin' number today."
He cocked his ears. Soon another voice made a remark, a girl's voice this time. The first voice had been a man's.
"Isn't there any other way?" asked the girl's voice.
It was sullen and dissatisfied, and the man's voice replied somewhat tartly, "What other way do you suggest?" Apparently the girl made no response, for the man repeated his question as though nervous and irritated.
"Oh, I don't care," said the girl's voice, in accents suggesting the accompaniment of a shrug. "It's all the same in the end."
"That's where you're a fool," rasped the man's voice. It was kept low, but Ben had no difficulty in hearing the words.
"It's not the same in the end. There's a hell of a difference. To you, I dare say. And to you, too.
Why—" The remark was interrupted by the dull sound of a train. Evidently there was a line running past the back of the shop.
"That's a bit funny, isn't it?" exclaimed the man's voice.
"What's funny?" demanded the girl's voice.
"Why, that train. I can't see where the fun comes in."
"Ear, ear," thought Ben. "What's funny in a train, except when it's on time?" The voices ceased, and the piece of bread and butter completed its postponed journey to Ben's mouth. While it was followed by another and another, Ben tried to visualize the owners of the voices. It may be mentioned that he visualized them all wrong. The man developed in his mind like Charlie Peace and the girl like Princess Mary. He began to fall into a reverie, but all at once he cocked his ears again. The conversation behind him was being resumed.
"Well, well, we needn't decide this minute," muttered the man, "but the only thing I can see is number 17. "Blimey, and it's the only thing I can hear," thought Ben. "I'll tell you what it is," retorted the girl. "You're getting nervy."
"Nervy, is it?"
"Yes. Nothing's happened to worry about yet. Why, we've only just—"
"Quiet," whispered the man fiercely. "Haven't you got any sense at all?" After a short silence, the girl's voice remarked with irony, "I haven't had much up till now, but it's coming."
"A bit cryptic, aren't you, my girl?" observed the man. "Then here's something else cryptic," she answered. Why will some people persist in wearing blinkers? Now we're going to have a little dust-up, thought Ben. 2-1 on the gal.
The dust-up did not materialize, however. Instead, a bulky form materialized walking up the shop. It was the bulky form of a policeman. And the policeman entered Ben's pew and sat down opposite him.
Well, I'm blowed, thought Ben. This is my lucky day. Thank God the bobbies don't turn up in 17s.
The policeman looked at Ben and nodded.
Pretty thick outside there, isn't it? He remarked.
Yes, answered Ben. Worst fog I ever remember, continued the policeman. Looks as if it's going to last a week.
Yes, said Ben. The policeman smiled. Putting something warm inside you, eh?
That's right. Well, tea's better than beer.
No, I mean, yes.
How would you like another cup?
Ben began to grow suspicious. People were not usually kind to him unless they had some ulterior motive.
No, thanks, Governor, he mumbled, rising abruptly. I got an appointment.
The police looked at him rather hard.
Where are you going to sleep tonight? He asked.
Out of the corner of his eye, Ben saw the waitress approaching.
Haven't really decided yet, he answered. Is the Ritz any good?
4 pence, said the waitress. While Ben forked out, the policeman seemed to be looking at him rather harder. In fact, he was so interested in Ben's pockets that Ben turned them inside out.
No deception, Governor, he remarked. There goes the end of it.
And it don't look much like the Ritz for you, observed the policeman. But of course, if you'd done a little post office robbery today, now you'd keep your notes in some other pocket, wouldn't you? Ben stared at him, and the policeman laughed.
Your face tells your story, mate. As well as your pockets, he said. There's a shilling for that bed at the Ritz.
Ben began to readjust his ideas about the police force.
What's this? He asked. A catch?
That depends on you, smiled the policeman and tossed him the coin. Ben caught it. It occurred to him that if he stayed any longer he might grow sentimental, or the policeman might want his shilling back. Both events would be pitiable. So, slipping the coin into his pocket, he murmured, "Tough, Governor, you're straight," and shuffled out of the shop. Through the fog once more, Ben resumed his strange way, drawing nearer and nearer every moment to the unseen port that was waiting for him. Warmed by the tea and cheered by his unexpected affluence, he groped his way along while the short day began to slip unnoticed into evening. The death of the day was not marked by gathering darkness, but by a change in the texture of a darkness already present.
"Wonder what it's all about," reflected Ben. "First that there ticket I picked up in that there pub, number 17, and then that there talk in that there restaurant, number 17 again, and then them bobbies, and then that feller leaving in the middle of his meal like that, then that face at the window. God, that gave me the creeps straight, and then those two quarrelling quiet-like, and then that bobby talking to me about it."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.